Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and in this video I'm going to present picture tests and practical anatomy of the abdomen. We will deal with the posterior abdominal wall, part 1. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer. Then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Identify the structures 1 and 2. What is the peritoneal relation of each B-specific? This is a parasagittal section of the body showing the abdomen. It is more deviated to the right. You can see here, this is the liver, the big part of the liver, the right lobe of the liver. Behind the liver, posteriorly, is a section in the kidney. You can see the cortex and medulla, medullary pyramids. And so 1 is the kidney. And then these are the loops of the small intestine. You can tell by the presence of the plicae circularis. They are more likely representing the jejunum or could be the beginning of the ileum as well. It is not the duodenum. The duodenum will be more posteriorly located and higher located at this location. This location represents the beginning of the duodenum or the pylorus of the stomach. So these loops here, which show the plicae circularis, the circular folds in the mucosa and submucosa to increase the surface area of absorption, they represent the jejunum or the ileum. Now, during development, the abdominal cavity is lined with parietal peritoneum, which lines the walls. Parietal or parietes means walls and parietal related to the walls. So the abdominal cavity, the walls of the abdominal cavity are lined with parietal peritoneum. But as the organs develop, they invaginate, and their invagination is to varying degrees. They invaginate into the peritoneal sac, and so they will acquire a peritoneal covering. This covering of peritoneum is called the visceral peritoneum because it is directly applied to the viscera. So they will push part of the peritoneum away from the wall. Some viscera, such as the stomach, the jejunum, ileum, which is represented in 2, the vermiform appendix, the transverse colon, sigmoid colon, and the spleen, are almost completely covered with visceral peritoneum. And the peritoneum will be reflected from the organ as a double fold of peritoneum. It could be called mesentery, it could be called ligament, or it could be called an omentum. But it is a double fold of peritoneum that suspends the organ from the abdominal wall. So in this sense, these structures are called intraperitoneal. So they are intraperitoneal in the sense of having a double fold of peritoneum, not in the sense that they lie in the peritoneal cavity. The peritoneal cavity is a very thin potential space that only contains a film of serous fluid. It does not contain organs, although some of the organs are called intraperitoneal. So number 2 is intraperitoneal. On the other hand, there are other structures which are called extraperitoneal or retroperitoneal organs, and they are only partially covered with peritoneum. They are not suspended from the wall by a double fold of mesentery. They are partially covered by peritoneum, on usually on their anterior wall. If they are covered by peritoneum from the superior wall, like in the case of the urinary bladder, they are called subperitoneal. The kidney, which is shown here in number 1, is therefore a retroperitoneal structure, but it is called a primary retroperitoneal structure because a retroperitoneal organ such as the kidney, ureter, suprarenal gland, they protrude into the peritoneal cavity and they remain in this position in the adult. So they start as retroperitoneal, end as retroperitoneal, while there are other retroperitoneal structures which are derivatives of the gut, are called secondary retroperitoneal organs initially because the whole gut, the primordial gut, is intraperitoneal and is suspended into the peritoneal cavity by a dorsal mesentery. So as the organs grow, organs that belong to the gastrointestinal tract, then their Posterior mesenteries, some of them might become gradually reduced and fuse with the parietal peritoneum, so they will have no more mesentery. An example here is the duodenum, which starts as intraperitoneal organ and then ends up to be mostly retroperitoneal. Only the beginning and the end of the duodenum are intraperitoneal. Same thing is true about the pancreas. Most of the pancreas is retroperitoneal, except the tip of its tail. The same is true for the ascending colon, descending colon, but not the transverse or sigmoid. Identify the structure A, name the fascia that separates it from the kidney, and identify the structure B, what is the type of its lining epithelium. Structure A is a suprarenal gland. This is the right suprarenal gland. Note its relation to the upper pole of the kidney. And also you can see that it is pyramidal in shape. This is opposed to the crescentic shape of the left suprarenal gland, which on the left, it is not only related to the upper pole, but also to the medial border of the kidney because it is crescentic shape. Regarding the fascia that separates it from the kidney, you will need to recall that the kidney and the suprarenal gland are surrounded by fat, fatty tissue, which is called perinephric fat or perirenal fat. Most of this fat has been dissected here in this specimen, but you can see here, this is the fat that has been dissected, the perinephric fat, and it is still retained here. This fat is surrounded by fascia, which is called the perinephric fascia. So the perinephric fascia of Gerota, sometimes called, or renal fascia, encloses the perinephric fat, and this also it encloses the kidney and the suprarenal gland. However, there is a septum. This fascia sends a septum that separates the kidney from the suprarenal gland. The presence of this septum of renal fascia allows the kidney to be removed from the donor without damaging the suprarenal gland. This fat and fascia, as well as the fat that is located outside, mainly posteriorly, which is not shown here, called paranephric fat, they are important factors that provide to keep the kidney in its position, in addition to the presence of the renal vessels and ureter that hold the kidney in position. The presence of fat and fascia, perinephric and paranephric fat, is an important stabilizing factor for the kidney. However, there is a normal mobility of the kidney of approximately 3 centimeters with respiration and when changing position from supine to erect position and vice versa. Structure B, obviously, is the ureter. This is a tubular structure descending down from the renal pelvis, which is located here at the hilum of the kidney, not very clear, and it descends down. It has abdominal and pelvic part. You can see its relation anterior to psoas major muscle, and the lining epithelium here is the same as the lining epithelium of the excretory urinary passages. It is the urothelium or transitional epithelium. Identify the zone of the kidney, be specific, and what is the predominant part of the renal tubule at this location. And then the fatty material that is shown here in B is in which part of the kidney and with which covering of the kidney it continues. This is a longitudinal section of the kidney. You can see that the kidney has a cortex, which is an outer zone, and a medulla, the inner zone. The medullary tissue is divided by the presence of columns called renal columns. This is cortical tissue in between medullary tissue. So the medullary tissue would become triangular in shape. That's why they are called renal pyramids. And you can see that the base of the renal pyramid is directed outward toward the renal cortex, while the apex of each renal pyramid projects inward toward the sinus of the kidney. This is the region of the sinus of the kidney, renal sinus. This apical projection of the pyramid is called the renal papilla, and it is from which the urine is excreted. You can see here, for example, it is surrounded by a small cup-shaped structure, which is called minor calyx. You can see evidence of calyces, minor calyces here, here, and here as well. So the predominant feature here in the tip of the medullary pyramid at the renal papilla is the presence of the collecting ducts. You don't expect to find the glomeruli, proximal or distal convoluted tubules. These are features of the cortex. And also the loops of Henle, they will dip into the medulla, but the collecting ducts are the distal part of the renal tubule that open eventually into the calyceal system is the predominant feature of the renal papilla. The fatty material here is located in the renal sinus, and this renal sinus is a narrow vertical space. It's like a pocket within the kidney and is entered through the hilum of the kidney. The hilum is the place where structures pass in and out. So that's why you can see that it is filled with blood vessels, artery, vein, calyceal system, renal pelvis. There are also lymphatics, nerves, which are not shown here, and it is stuffed with fat. This fat enters the pocket from outside through the hilum. Outside the kidney, the fat surrounds the kidney as the perinephric fat. So it is the continuation of the perinephric fat that surrounds the kidney. Identify the structure. What is its two terminal branches? Identify the structure. Name the nerve plexus from which it originates. This is the posterior abdominal wall dissection showing the aorta. It's a plastinated specimen, so you can see that there is a lot of shrinkage here. So it shows the abdominal aorta a little bit to the left of the midline, and to the right of it is the inferior vena cava. If you follow the aorta distally, you will find that it bifurcates into two common iliac arteries. So A is a left common iliac artery, and it's called common because it divides soon into an external and internal iliac arteries. And these are the two terminal branches of the artery A. The external iliac artery continues to supply the lower limb as the femoral artery distal to the inguinal ligament, and the internal iliac artery, as shown here, it dips into the pelvis and provides the major blood supply for pelvic structures. Regarding the nerve B, this is the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh, or lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, and it is derived from the lumbar plexus. This plexus is a network of nerves formed by the anterior primary rami of nerves L1 to L4, and these nerves, they divide, reunite within the substance of the psoas major muscle. You can see the psoas major muscle here. And so the branches of the plexus, you cannot see the plexus because it is within the muscle, but the branches of the plexus are related to psoas major muscle. So they are either anterior, or they are medial, or they are lateral to the muscle. The lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh has a root value of L2 and L3. Remember that the plexus, lumbar plexus, is from L1 to L4. And so this has a root value of L2 and L3. And it emerges from the lateral border of the psoas major muscle. Usually it is below the iliac crest. You can see the iliac crest. This is the iliacus muscle here. Below it in the iliac fossa, and the nerve obviously passes obliquely and downwards across iliacus muscle toward the anterior superior iliac spine, where the inguinal ligament is attached, and the nerve passes deep to the ligament to enter the thigh, where it supplies a skin area indicated by its name on the lateral side of the thigh. That's why it's called the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Note that there is another nerve arising lateral to psoas major muscle, inferior to the iliac crest, and this is the femoral nerve, but obviously this nerve is much bigger than the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh because the femoral nerve supplies more cutaneous areas as well as muscles and joints. One point to be mentioned about the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh is that there is a medical condition called neuralgia parastatica that results from compression of this nerve. As it passes deep to the inguinal ligament, it might be compressed by the ligament against the bone, anterior superior iliac spine, and this will result in aching, burning, numbness, or even sometimes a stabbing pain in the lateral side of the thigh, the area that is supplied by the nerve.